complex.
No.
And anybody who hasn't paid their dues would better come and see me. $3. I'm going to break you forever. Okay. Beyond that, our speaker, Bill Geraci, is here. And he's going to tell us about human nature. The actual nature of human nature. Bill Geraci!
I am very happy to be here. I mean, everybody has to be somewhere, but I am very happy to be here. I have a joke to start with that I find funny. I was going to give a talk on humility, but not enough of you showed up. So my name is Bill Geraci. I gave a series of talks here in 2008, 2009. And apparently most of you have forgotten them because I see some familiar faces. This was one of those talks, but it's even better now, I hope. So this is the actual nature of human nature. The reason I'm giving you this talk is because I hope to propagate this and other talks in other environs. So if you know any other groups that could put up with me, or maybe even benefit from what I figured out, I'll be happy to talk to you about giving more talks. I'm happy to announce that this talk will not be an in-depth and careful study of other philosophical wanderings on the topic of human nature. For instance, nature versus nurture, physis versus, what's the other Greek word? That other Greek word. I'm sure that many of you have fought that battle before and wandered about and discussed and declaimed, and we won't be doing that. This talk is the actual nature of human nature, and by that I mean stuff that I've actually seen and I've actually figured out. It's not a rationale or a philosophical position. It's an explanation of what I've seen. I'm going to be giving you some numbers in a few minutes, some percentages. I want to start out by saying that I have made those up, but I think that they reflect what I have seen. I'm sure you'll all understand that 72.8% of all statistics are made up anyway. I just want to start with that. One tool that I want to give you is one that I use and have used for a long time. When I figure something out, I run it through what I call the funnel theorem. Funnels, as you know, start out really wide and go down very narrow. A really great idea will survive the funnel theorem. A good idea will just work. Workable idea. Oh yeah, one of my philosophies of talks is that there's nothing so practical as a good theory. So the theories I'm about to give you, I hope, will actually be of practical use. So a good idea works at all, which is actually high praise. There are lots of ideas around that don't work, as far as I can tell. But a great idea will survive the funnel theorem. And what I mean by that is you take the understanding you gain and you put it through the widest, largest circumstance you can think of, and then you run it down into the smallest tactical circumstance and see if it still applies. This is a tough test. There are lots of ideas that will work in a certain range, but when you try and get down to the nitty-gritty, for example, it won't work. But there are things that will work in the nitty-gritty, but when you take it out to a whole society, say, or a whole religion, history of a religion, it won't apply. I'm happy to say that the ideas I'm about to give you, I've run through the funnel theorem, and I find them working at all levels. I hope by the end of the talk you'll be able to help me out if I have erred in that. So the actual nature of human nature. I have two sentences. Either of these sentences or both of these sentences explain what 80% of human beings do. Well, actually that's not right. They don't explain what humans do. Humans do all sorts of things. They explain why human beings do that.
What can I do? Can you do it?
The first of that sentence is
chicken noodle
minestrone. We've always done it that way.
The usual?
Yes.
How many of you have done stuff or seen stuff done? And when you say, why on earth did you do that ridiculous way? Or why did you come up with that inspired thing you did?
Ranch.
And a lot of the time the answer is, we've always done it that way. Mm-hmm. The other sentence that taken together explains 80% is, well, it seemed like a good idea at the time. Now, these two sentences sound frivolous, but they're not. They're touchstones to understand a bunch of important stuff we're going to get to in a long time. And I also have something to say about the 20% that isn't accounted for by these two sentences. The reason that people overwhelmingly use these two explanations is that they interlock and stem from the following understandings. The three biggest elements in the human mind, in human nature. The first and by far the most important is habit. Some of you may think the most important thing in the human experience and human nature and the human mind would be caring, or love, or hate, for that matter. No, it's habit. And of course, this locks directly into, well, we've always done it that way. There are some really good things about habit. One of the good things about habit is that you don't have to rethink it. That makes life simpler and easier. Of course, there are really bad things about habit, the most important of which is when circumstances change, your habits may lead you to trouble, and indeed, dare I say it, great trouble. But they often work pretty well. The next two of the three factors in human nature are not as important as habit, but very important nonetheless. They are self-delusion and rationalization. These two make up the background for the sentence, well, it seemed like a good idea at the time. I want you to notice as a sideline, I have this really awkward sentence I had to read. These two explanations interlock into and stem from. You remember that? Wasn't that a painful piece of writing? You don't. You guys are listening, right? Just checking. Okay, so I read this horrible sentence. These two explanations interlock and stem from. And then I gave you what that is. What I wanted to say is they're part of. But you can't say that with the same meaning anymore. How many of you have noticed or read or discerned that the word part, as in part of, has changed immensely in the last, now, 100 years, just about 100 years, 110 years. There was a time when part meant organic whole, as in integrated within. In fact, interlocking and stemming from. But, this is all an aside, but since about 1915 or so, the word part has taken on an entirely different meaning. Anyone notice what I'm talking about? Anyone see what changed around 1915, 1920? That changed the word? I'm sorry?
I wasn't here.
You weren't here. Well, actually, I wasn't either. But it's that reading thing, you know. Mass production, as in industrial production, as in Henry Ford. Part took on an entirely different meaning. Part before industrial production was an integral part, right? You couldn't separate it without killing the thing. You vivisect it. But after you get to industrial mass production, the part becomes merely an interchangeable thing. Not really very important, not really related to anything else organically or completely. And that's why I had to use that really awkward phrasing. I think that's fascinating. No? Okay, fine. Okay, let's...
It actually is very interesting.
See? This guy is awake. Well put, sir. I agree with you completely. You said it was fascinating. Okay, so let's explore these ideas. This is the lay of the land. If you really press for time, you can now leave, because I've told you the important bit. But I'm now going to elaborate and try and make sense and give examples. All that kind of stuff, talks. People give talks, do that. So there are some societal variations I would guesstimate at. In Stalin's Russia, for example, I would assume that those two explanations, well, we've always done it this way, or well, it seemed like a good idea at the time, might rise to 95%, because it was quite dangerous to do anything different than what had already been approved. In the United States of America in 2014, here and now, I would assume it would be about 80%. For this brilliant group, that's flattery, in case you missed that. For this brilliant group, I would assume it'd be nearly 78%. And for me, the guy who discerned this idea, the guy who figured this out, I would say it's merely 77%. I mean, this really is a huge element of explanation of what people do and why they do. So some illustrations of habit, what I mean by habit. First off, it's very difficult to illustrate because it's so common. It would be like illustrating the importance of water. I mean, it's just, everybody does this. How could you divvy it out? Nonetheless, I have some examples. In 2009, there was a stimulus crisis a stimulus package to try and smooth over the crisis from the financial guys. Anyone recall that? It was of some importance at the time, if you may notice that. And most of us were there for that, so there. It didn't work the last time this was tried. FDR's New Deal program in the 1930s did not work. It did help a lot of individuals. It did do a lot of good, but it didn't work, right? What was the goal? To drag the United States economy out of the Great Depression. What got the United States economy out of the Great Depression?
World War II.
Massive employment. In fact, the money that they were inventing and pushing into the economy with the New Deal was actually being sucked out of the economy by your friends and mine at the Federal Reserve. We were tied to the gold standard at the time, and they were afraid that as countries moved their gold into the United States to protect it from the European war and the Asian war as well, they feared an inflation. So you actually, even though they were inventing money and putting it out into the economy, again, which helped a lot of real people, there's still bridges people drive over that are from this period, but the economy actually shrank. There was deflation during this period, so
that's
they were being pushed back. That's not true?
That's not true.
Well, as long as I have the mic.
During the first year, Roosevelt took 1% of the time.
What I should say, actually, that when I give a talk, I'm happy to give you the best of my understandings up until that moment.
Oh.
And that can change. Never can. Sorry. I'm just being polite. So when you did this stimulus thing in 2009, they've also tried it other times during other emergencies. I mean, this is an illustration of habit. We've always done it this way. When we have this kind of problem, we do this kind of answer. Politicians must be seen to care, and they must appear to do something. It actually is not so important that what they're actually doing is the right thing to do, or even a good thing to do. They must appear. Another illustration of this is small arms in the Civil War. As the Civil War loomed, there were guys who came to the United States federal government and said, we can produce for you mass-produced guns with interchangeable parts. And the United States government tested these, the military tested these, and they were quite swell and less expensive, and they didn't go with them. The reason they didn't go with them, of course, was we've always done it with flintlocks. We have to use flintlocks, right? Generals always fight the previous war. And in fact, it wasn't until the Indian Wars of the 1880s, more or less, when the Indians, not being subject to this prejudice, we're happy to get repeating rifles and mass-produced rifles. The U.S. had to go with this trend. And another example of habit actually working against your own best self-interest.
No, I get it, Chris.
Thank you. I offer as an illustration of self-delusion. Me.
Thank you, Chris.
So here I am giving this talk. I'm wondering why I would give you this talk. Is it because I'm willing to help you by sharing a few hard-won understandings with you? Or is it because I have a massive ego and I'm wanting to tell you the right way to understand things and the right way to live? And by that I mean a teacher, of course. Well, the answer is, of course, both of those things are true. But that's an illustration of self-delusion. There are a lot of people who teach and think they're merely humble persons. Every teacher I've ever known, if you push them against a wall, figuratively, of course, they will be willing, hopefully willing to admit that the reason they're teachers and are willing to work in for less salary and such is because they actually feel that their understanding is the best one you can have. It's kind of a self-delusion. Another illustration of self-delusion. How many of you think that we live in a democracy? Good. The rest of you either have no opinion, which is very sad, or you would agree with me that we don't, never have, and we're never supposed to. The United States governmental system has very large elements of democracy in it. Well, first off, if you met any Athenian on the street and described our political system as a democracy, what would he say to you?
Not so.
Okay. Not so. Definitely not so. And why would it not be so?
Because we all don't go to Washington to participate.
That's right. We have the parts of our governmental system that are democratic are representative democracy. This would be ridiculous to any good Athenian citizen. Ridiculous on the face of it. But it's worse than that. Our governmental system has strong elements of democracy in it, but it is never intended to be democratic. If it were actually democratic, here I'm using the small d system, not the Democratic Party. If it were meant to be democratic, what is it with these nine people, they used to be only men, but these nine people who sit and can invalidate laws and actions of the representatives, and by that I mean the Supreme Court. There's nothing democratic about it. They have life terms, for crying's sake, and they're not even directly elected. This isn't a great exercise in self-delusion when you talk to politicians who say that our democracy is the greatest democracy. No. We, as I recall, until corrected, which could happen at any point, our system, when advertised to the states to get it approved so that we could have this federal system, the Constitution, it was called free government.
Yeah. Thank
you. Not a democracy.
Hi, guys. Maybe we can just a moment.
Another illustration is of rationalization. Humans are meaning-assigning animals. When humans wander about the planet, they assign meaning to things, often with no actual care about what they're actually seeing or doing or what meaning it may have. I have had a hand in raising children. I won't say I've raised them because I have a wife and she would be happy to disagree with the degree of my contribution, but I have had a hand in raising children. And I used to be amazed at the deep contemplative look that these very young children have, you know, 3 or 4 or 5 months old, just looking into my eyes with the most endearing, deep, until I noticed they gave that same look to blank white wall. Okay? So human beings will assign meaning. I mean, how many arguments have you stayed out of with parents who are saying that their child just smiled? Right? Random facial movement. Look, he, she, or it has smiled. Okay? So human beings will assign meaning, and not just about their own children.
Yeah, my cat smiled.
My wife has a master's in science, and she has, when she was gestating our lovely children, she spent more time trying to discern their sex with little tests than I could believe possible by a human being. There were, how many R's were in the months that she and I were born? If it was an even number, there was a thing with pencils and string where if the pencil went one way, then it was a girl.
Pencil.
You remember, how many of you have at least heard of these things?
Oh, no. I use it.
Do you,
all
you,
the time.
Yes, like, yeah, yeah, okay, so turning or... Yeah. And my point, was it is a 50-50 chance. Which means the odds of you being right or wrong are 50-50, which, well, okay, 49-51. Now, if we had, if our species had three sexes, right, then you'd have a third. Then you could actually track these down and see if these things did anything. But as far as I know, that's not how that works.
Some people would say there are three sexes.
That's a really frightening thought. We'll leave that to your talk. But this is an illustration of rationalization. People will make up stuff. And in fact, the more important it is, the more likely they are to make it up. And there's an exception to this rule, making up stuff, rationalization. And that is large organizations. I have noticed that large organizations are actually cause irrational behavior in large groups. So when you talk to most people and discuss what we should do about X, most people will eventually come around to something vague and say, I have known large organizations to come up with the most ludicrous plans. How many of you know the book The March of Folly? Right? It's a good book. I commend it. It's a historian. It's a woman historian.
Barbara Tuckman.
Barbara Tuckman, what he said. And in this book, she offers four examples of governments, large organizations, deliberately working not in their own best self-interest. So I'm talking about how human beings will rationalize what they do, but I'm saying human beings in large groups will commonly go crazy and call it official policy, as far as I can tell. The Trojan horse, really? They had to actually break the archway to get that Trojan horse inside of Troy, and they thought it was a nice gift from the Greeks. Really? The United States participated, these are examples from the Book of March of Fall. She's got four major examples. The United States policy in Vietnam. I'm sorry. I can't see the sense of it. Slavery. And I would offer the 2009 banking crisis, both how it happened and what happened when it happened, as examples of large organizations going crazy. This habit of large organizations is sort of a combination of we've always done it this way and a rationalization taken to its logical extreme, and by that I mean bad stuff. So let's talk about the other 20%. Right? If these two sentences, well, it seemed like a good idea at the time, and, well, we've always done it that way. If those two sentences explain 80% of what human beings do, I hope some of you are interested in the 20% that isn't a result of these things. And if you are, I'll wake you when I'm done. Okay. I will tell you that 10% of people making decisions, not on those bases, is because people have freed themselves or been freed to some degree from habit and or rationalization and or self-delusion. Okay. It is possible to actually look at the world in a more sensible way and actually discern and understand what's going on as opposed to just saying, well, when this happened, we always do that. And I'd like to suggest that this choice to look at the world as it really is, as opposed to just habit, may not always be a joyous choice. And by that I mean people will often be driven to not just do what we've always done before, because they finally figured out that what we've always done before has not worked. I'm not suggesting that all habits we have, personally or societally, are always bad. They're not. But often they are quite bad. And people still do them anyway. I mean, if you look at mental health, as far as I can figure, commonly, certainly not in all circumstances. People have these structures in their mind to deal with problems because they had some trauma in the past. And they continue to use that same mental habit to deal with the present, where that danger has gone away. This is an example of being stuck in a habit that can be bad for you. But of course, we only talk about the stuff that's bad, right? We don't talk about things that aren't problems. So there are plenty of habits people have personally and societally that are very good and appropriate. What about the other 10%, right? So 10% are people who freed themselves from this common limitation. The other 10% I'm going to call inspiration. There's a reason I call it inspiration. It's because I can't give you an explanation of it. You know, you see a bunch of birds flying and they all seem to turn at the same time. And there's no obvious, it's not like, okay, everybody, we're going to go left, right? There's no obvious communication that we can discern. What do we do when we run into that? What's the explanation given?
Follow the leader.
No, but they all turn. I don't mean, you know, the guy in front turns and then they...
Somebody
instinct.
Instinct. Exactly so. People will say it's instinct. And what does that mean? It means we don't understand it, but if we call it instinct, we'll feel better about it. Right? This is actually a form of rationalization. So I'm going to tell you the other 10% is inspiration. And then I'm not going to say any more because I don't know more than that. I hope that's not too upsetting. Now I'm going to give you a lucky strike extra. How many of you know what a lucky strike extra is?
One is coming.
There's a guy who knows what a lucky strike extra is. You guys really don't know. I thought this group would know. Well, a lucky strike is a cigarette, yes.
No.
It's a lucky strike extra.
That was from the hit parade.
That's right, it's from the hit parade. For decades on radio and then television, there was a very popular show called the hit parade. Frank Sinatra was on it for a while. He's got Marlboros, which are not the same as a lucky strike extra.
Much better flavor. Much better flavor. Come to Marlboro country.
LSMFT, Lucky Strike means fine tobacco.
There's a guy who knows. Okay.
Call
so they had this show
Philip
called
Morris.
The
Sweaters,
There was originally a radio show and then became a TV show called Your Hit Parade, where they would play the top 10 songs in reverse order. So everyone would be thrilled, everyone would tune in. And what they did is, in order to promote some other songs, they had Lucky Strike Extras. Right? So you get the 10 songs, but you can't fill up 30 minutes of airtime with that kind of thing. You need something quicker so that you have time to fill. So they had Lucky Strike Extras. So this is a Lucky Strike Extra. I've explained why humans act as they do. More or less, thank you. I'm happy to accept more or less. Let's now look at how the world works. And by the way, there is the world outside of the human mind. Really, there is. There's been some philosophical argument on this, but I'm here to tell you there is. This is, of course, a suicide prevention talk. This part of the talk is a suicide prevention talk. As far as I have been able to discern, the operating principle for the cosmos, and by this I mean, you know, physical objects, stuff that falls down, stuff that we build, cars we drive, planetary motion, I mean, the world outside of our own minds, operates on the basis of apparent random chance. Now, I have chosen those words carefully, and I'll explain that in a moment. But you'll recall that the most important element of human nature is habit. Does anyone see any potential conflict between these two? Human beings operate in the world believing that the stuff they've done in the past will continue to operate into the future. Habit, right? But the world operates on the basis of apparent random chance. It's all around us, all the time. There's all sorts of stuff that happens, and doesn't make sense. This microphone I'm speaking through was dropped not once, friends, not twice, but three times before the talk. Who could have ever predicted such a thing? Right? Apparent random chance. I'm not saying everything is apparent. Everything is apparent random chance. But the stuff you remember, the stuff you have to work with that are problems, are caused by apparent random chance. Now, if you have human beings who operate on habit, and you have a world that works on apparent random chance, the structure of these and this is part of our joyous human experience, or at least our human experience. In fact, it's part of a lot of crap we have to deal with in our lives, that these conflict. And I'm going to contend that suicides, people who kill themselves, are often working in a rigid mental way, habits, and they cannot deal with what the world actually presents them. And this condition can become intolerable to the human being. So, if you can understand the role of habit and also understand apparent random chance as the operating principle of the cosmos, I would like to suggest that you may be able to at least tolerate the world a little easier. Loved ones die, buildings fall down, people get fired, right? If you only look at the world expecting things to be as they have been, you are in deep trouble. Because apparent random chance is what explains what the world is.
Okay.
Wow.
Now I
take. Let me give an example or two of apparent random chance. When I moved to Chicago in 1983, I applied for and got a job at Orly's Restaurant in Hyde Park. Anyone know Orly's?
Yeah,
right? They've now changed the name. They do New Orleans style food, something like that. Orly's worked on a 2-week schedule, right? Not 1 week like most places, but 2 weeks. And I happened to be granted that job at a time when they were in the middle of the beginning of the 2-week block. So I didn't have any hours for 2 weeks.
They're all homemade.
Which kind of pissed me off. So I went and applied for a job at the Medici on Harper.
Okay.
Anyone remember the Medici on Harper? Very nice restaurant. It's not still there. That whole complex is
the best I can.
Yeah. The guy, the other cook that trained me, is a guy who, his wife worked with a woman who I knew, and she became my wife. Now, how random is that? Right? If Orly's had had a weekly schedule, I would have never met him. And if I had never met that guy, the odds are I would have never met my wife. You see what I mean by apparent random chance? I mean, if you try and discern a reason for that, right? Human beings are meaning-assigning animals. If you try and assign a reason for that, you're not going to get there. Right? It's not, I mean, I can pretend it was the will of God. She needed to find me so we would, you know what I mean? I can pretend all that. But I can, there's no even vaguely reasonable explanation for what happened. And that kind of stuff goes on all the time. In most human endeavors, the phrase, quote, "Isn't that funny that, ... close quote, explains a lot of this apparent random chance. That has meaning. There's apparent random chance that doesn't have meaning. You know, it doesn't affect other things. But apparent random chance that has meaning is usually explained, like instinct with the birds, or inspiration is my shovingly way of not explaining that other 10%. Those things are important.
I'm sorry.
Okay. But you may be wondering why I say apparent random chance and not random chance. How many of you are wondering that? Yes, you should be wondering. Why did I use it? It's more syllables. You know, in English, working out of syllables is everything you can do. It turns out the word apparent is extremely important for two completely diverse reasons. First reason is pretty obvious if you think about it. I have to call it apparent random chance so they don't burn me at the stake. There was a time that if you excluded God or some higher power from ordering the universe, they would burn you at the stake. It was not done. It was not approved. It was not allowed. So I have to put apparent random chance in there. The other reason I put apparent in there is because I don't think it's random. But I also cannot fathom all the explanations. Maybe it is God pulling strings. Maybe it's karma. Take your pick. But apparent random chance covers certainly how it appears and keeps me from being burned at the stake. And I understand that being burned at the stake is really quite unpleasant. So I'm against it. So the last slide I have here is the way to happiness. Having explained how human nature works, having explained how the world works, I thought I'd give you, put them together and give you the key. This is how to achieve happiness. Become habitually more ready to reevaluate and revise habits and habitual explanations. I'm going to say that again. It's just the kind of guy I am. I apologize in advance. Become habitually more ready, right? So it's a continuing, accelerating process if you're lucky. Become habitually more ready to reevaluate and revise habits, that is actual things you do, as well as habitual explanations, right? The mental stuff. Why do I understand why this happens? I'm going to suggest that you habitually become willing to revise and reevaluate those. And having explained human activity in the cosmos, and how the cosmos behaves, and how to become happy, I'm done for now. Okay. I'm going to go have a seat.
What we're going to do is take breaks. We're going to take a you just need to use the bathroom and take a break for a few
minutes. When I teach, I like to go in 50-10s. Okay. I don't think that dedication and understanding should be based on bladder capacity.
All right, well, if you're ready to go, if you're ready to go into questions right away, we can start, and if we need a break, we can break for a minute or two.
Oh, I'm ready. Trust okay. me, I'm ready.
All right, let's thank our speaker.
All right. Let's thank this guy.
Oh, man. I don't know where to begin. I'm going to slaughter this guy. Let's be gentle.
I have the first question, Brahm. Me that Bill went.
Come on.
Well, Bill went past their hand up and Tim Bolger is followed, and I think Mike is about to ask a question.
He has a racist hand.
All right, Bill.
Can you explain the difference between exegesis and eisegesis?
One's outside and one's inside.
It's the Bible.
If I recall correctly, those are philosophical and maybe even divinity related terms for tactics for examining stuff.
The Bible.
Well, when you're reading a document, whether it's sacred or the New York Times, you can read into it, that's eisegesis. From the German into reading, or exegesis is reading from the text itself what exactly it says.
I interpret the
Bible. It's from the Greek, though.
Yeah.
all the good ones are from the Greek.
Yeah.
That's that Christians.
Really? I guess that's it.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know you addressed suicide. So, from what I'm gleaning from what you're saying, to avoid suicide, embrace change around you as part of the given. The change, you said it a different way, but the concept of change is something that we have to cope with.
I think the fact that human beings are primarily driven by, let me rephrase that. I think the fact that human beings can and usually are primarily driven by habit, contrasted against the cosmos, which is apparent random chance, is a cause of some suicides and other unhappinesses. I mean, suicide is the ultimate and horrifying illustration of that. But lots of inharmonics, emotional and mental and spiritual trouble is because of that.
So can you equate the cosmos, what you're saying, with change that swirls around us?
Oh, yeah. The cosmos is
that's it. Yeah.
What swirls around us, and it does change.
Yeah, okay.
Even a lot of philosophical nuts will tell you that the cosmos is actually around us in a swirl. But I'm telling you that it's going to apparently randomly change, and if you're not ready for it, it will hurt.
All right. All right. I want you to comment on the following scripture passage from Romans 7:15. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do I do not do, but what I hate that I do.
I would say I need to come talk to that.
What does that have to do with the cops winning the pennant?
Well, that's yeah. Human nature, my friend. It's all about human nature.
I wonder why they came.
Are you familiar with the book, Sacred Cows Make the Best Burgers?
No, but it sounds intriguing.
Okay, it's really good because it hits into all the things that you were talking about in terms of habit and why people do the same thing all the time and we do it all the time. And it's filled with business examples where people did stuff that all of a sudden they didn't do it and it came out better. And some of the corporations were giving, they had a cowbell in their corporation. And when anybody broke one of their sacred cows, one of their things that they always did or we always did, but they did it differently and they had success, sales went up, somebody would ring the bell. So the whole book is filled with, it makes that point that you said.
I love that.
It's probably, I bet it's about 96. It's an older book. You can borrow it.
When I start a new job, one of the things I do is I have a three-ring binder. It's back in the days of paper. And I would write down all the stuff that didn't make good sense to me. And I would ignore that book for about 6 months, and then I would read through it. And about a third of the stuff is, oh, okay, now I understand why we do that. And a third of the stuff is, I'm going to go ask someone. And a third of the stuff is, oh, my God, that's ridiculous. I've gotten used to it, right? You can get used to anything. I've gotten used to it, but when I saw it with fresh eyes, it was ridiculous, and so I wrote it in the book. And now that I've been doing this job for a while, it's still ridiculous. And we should still not do it, or at least, find a better, yeah. Yeah, I like that. That's good.
Right. Let's see. Was there, Don Ritchie, and then Chuck?
Are you related to Peter Francis Tracy, the personal injury lawyer?
Not that I know of.
Oh, okay.
If it will make me money, I can pretend.
Francis Tracy.
Is that it?
Yeah, that's my question.
I'm happy to
help you. Okay, now, Bill, certain behaviors are, we perform an act and we're positively reinforced, and they become what you call habits. But that's utilitarian, makes sense. Why would I then engage in activities which might negatively respond, generate negative responses? So habits are very positive. They work. They're utilitarian.
That's a wonderful question. It allows me to dismantle the entirety of that mess. Okay. So,
I got a knife and a fork and a spoon. I'm not going to, try a new way of eating because this is like a habit.
Never use chocolate.
I should break.
Okay. So let's say we encounter a circumstance and we figure out what we want to do that takes care of that circumstance. So it works for us, whatever that is. Is that how all habits are formed?
Yes.
No.
Classical conditioning.
Not nearly. Okay? I would contend that as people walk down the street living their lives, probably two-thirds of their habits do not come out of their own mind at all. You read stuff, and you say, huh, that's an interesting idea. You see people do stuff. You watch TV shows. You see movies. You get an inspiration from God. Whatever. Most habits people have are more or less inherited, right? You go to work, and they say, all right, we need to do these 82 things twice every day. And most of those you don't sit and figure out on your own. They say, no, when you do this, when this comes up, you do those four things. right? That's not a habit I've learned. I mean, I've learned in the sense that they told me and I've done it. But that's not one I figured out. I don't think most habits are created out of people's own figuring. I think most habits are either seen and imagined or instructed, right? I mean, I have a great sense of humor.
I don't know if you've noticed that, but
in case you haven't, I'm telling you I have a great sense of humor. And it really pisses me off that most of it is my father's sense of humor. Because he's not very funny. But I've gotten most of those humorous habits, right, how to play with words and whatever, and how to deliver a line, from him. It's not like I sat and I said, how could I be funny? Well, let's see, I could, you know what I mean?
He
so
reinforced
I don't think the premise of your idea is true sometimes. Right? Some habits we do actually figure out on our own. But a lot of them, and I think a lot of the most important ones, we don't figure out on our own. We get them from various sources.
Where do nuns get their habits?
I'm going to say something rare and unusual. That's beneath my response. Even grace that with response.
I have a problem with the random. I think university, again, I chaos. They just structure, there are rooms, okay? But it's chaotic, okay? But it's not like a, not random.
Well, I like that point, and I'm happy to take it. What I mean, there are laws of physics. I agree. I mean, there. I mean, when I said earlier about the movement of the planets and things, those are actually pretty regular. But the reason I didn't approach it that way. There are a couple reasons I did that. I didn't approach it that way. I mean, I know what you're talking about. The main reason is, as a teacher, I have to lie. It's required. In the structure of the job that every teacher has to learn. I mean, think of any topic you want to teach someone. You'll say, this is true. And you'll spend another week and a half taking it back. Well, it's not true in all circumstances. It's not true here, it's not true. But you have to start with a simple structure, and then you can, if you're good and if you're lucky, you'll have time to unpack that a little bit. If we had like four sessions to elaborate on this, what a fate that would be. But if we had four sessions, I would have started with a simpler version and then worked back out. So there is regularity in the cosmos. But what we remember is not the regularity. As human beings, we don't remember when things work as they have. We remember when they don't. And that's what I'm talking about. I'm talking about how we understand and deal with things when they don't work. I mean, you can talk about the orbits of the planets. I'm talking about the human experience. Why did that guy die? I love that guy. Why did he die? Right? That kind of stuff appears as apparent random chance.
Yeah, God giving.
Well, we could talk about that.
Yeah.
See, so I agree with you, but there's a reason that I didn't elaborate as much. And I think what I said is still right. Notice how I fit that in.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm right on your way, I'm right my way.
Don't you share?
It's good enough question.
Well, one thing you haven't really touched on in regards to habits is the convenience of adapting to what we know. For example, we live in the United States here, all the driving wheels are on the left side of the car. Right. But if you go over to Britain, England, or Australia, it's going to be on the right side. And you have to use a different part of the road when you drive down in those countries versus the way we drive up here. I just went through a class where we were learning how to use the smartphones and the screens that you can flip up and down and you have to touch and all that. And I found the typing very frustrating, you know. And so, you know, you get used to keyboards, but, you know, we're constantly having to adapt, and I think that's troublesome for people. Even in some countries, you know, in certain parts of the world, they read right to left, and you read from the back to the front. Yeah. We read our books front to back and left to right. So, you know, you would have a lot of frustration adapting, you know. And
Dan's check.
Good reasons for
your check.
Staying, you know, within a restriction of
what you're able to do in habits.
Yeah, it's kind of great to have.
There are advantages to habits. But I, to take you on a personal journey of mine, in my life, let me tell you what a sick, sad, twisted human being I have been over the years. I used to think efficiency, being efficient, which actually is largely being habitual. Being efficient was an unalloyed good. Was an unalloyed good. It was always good to be efficient. It's not. It's not. Inefficiency not only is necessary because of apparent random chance, inefficiency is actually better. One of the drawbacks of efficiency is being thoughtless. If you do something habitually and efficiently all the time, it will get to the point, as you get older, where you won't remember if you've done it. Right? Where people who habitually lock all the doors of the house before they leave, and then they habitually go back and check all the doors. Right? Because they're so used to checking them. But that's true. But my point is, if efficient, being efficient and being habitual makes you unthinking. Which not only makes you unable to anticipate and respond correctly, helpfully to change, and change is, right? Apparent random chance is how the cosmos works. Being efficient and habitual not only makes it difficult to change, but you may not even see that there's been a change, because you're only used to seeing, you see what I mean? So that being efficient and habitual has a negative side. And there are a lot of people who don't understand that, and it's important. And I didn't understand it either, which is back in one of my many earlier wretched periods. Does that make any sense? Is that a useful response to your question?
Vicky,
very good. Thank you. Given what you've said about habit, would it not then make sense that we introduce some subtle changes in our life that may not have any clearly defined better outcomes for us, just to shake things up and leave ourselves less fossilized, drive a different route to work, anything just to
that
shake it up?
That sounds exhausting. But yes, there's good news though. It doesn't matter whether you think to try that. The cosmos is going to give it to you anyway. Right? Because the cosmos is apparent.
You could sign a sweetheart.
So you drive the same way to work every day. You drive the same way. You don't have to think about it. Drive the same way. Construction. Now I have to go somewhere else. Right? Well, they put a bypass through and close off the whole area. I mean, the cosmos will make you reconsider. You have no choice. It is how it works. So, for instance, I work as a staff guy at the University of Chicago Divinity School. And there was this back door to our place that has this lovely, you know, bushes, and you've got the curated, whatever that word is, the carved limestone stuff, you know, it's just beautiful. I think people walk by it all the day and ignore it. So I thought, I know what I'll do. I will take a picture standing in the same place at basically the same time of day when I come in, every day for a year, right? And I'll be able to morph these in and blend them. You get a whole year of this beautiful thing. People will see it. It'll be really nice. I thought this was great, right? And then they close it for construction. Now here I am trying to bring out the beauty in the cosmos, and the cosmos whaps me upside the head and says, so you think this has been the same way for 100 years? And now we're going to change it. And when they were done with construction, they had moved the bushes around. I was really pissed about this. Okay? But that's because I expected the world to continue to work in the same way. I am a fool, as are we all.
So you're telling me then that the construction on a 990 is divinely inspired?
Depends on when they're done, whether it's any good.
Ian gets the second question. Ian?
No, I was just going to mention Alan Langer's work on mindlessness. Have you read that?
Nope.
Because the whole mindless thing, I mean, she's done all these studies on what mindlessness is, and it kind of fits into habitual too, but it's another whole... I think she might be from a social work background, social sciences, but Langer's work, look into that, on mindlessness.
Sounds great.
It's, again, more examples of big places do it, like in a geriatric center where they ask everybody, what's the temperature out today? What is it bright or sunny? And these are residents who don't go outside. And if they don't know or they get the wrong answer, oh, they're disoriented. They don't know. And it was more like a mindless act that they just always go around and ask them this and ask them, but why? What good is it? What's the benefit? Not even, there's no thoughtfulness behind it to make that change.
I'm always happy when people agree with me.
Thank you. Do you need change?
Okay, Mr. Wentz got a second question.
Bill has had his hand up for both. Yes, you haven't asked questions yet.
Thank you, my dear.
Is it Moody?
Ian.
Ian.
I just had a couple ideas listening to all this. The first, well, the three different things. The one would be, like, just changing something up randomly. One of the easiest things to look at would be, what's the first thing you do when you wake up? And for a lot of us, it's hop in the shower, turn on the hot water, 10, 15 minutes. That's most people. And so a simple thing that you could do as far as habit change goes is turn on cold water. And the idea
Why?
Isn't to torture yourself, and you're going to be screaming.
Why?
But, and there's TED Talks on this, doing something so simple like that and having it become something that you say, okay, this isn't how we do it, but it's how I'm doing it, will play on that idea of inspiration. And it's surprising how many people that have documented themselves doing that have gone on to make other changes, and it can be changes to anything, but just doing one simple thing can rocket you into the idea of change in general, because I do believe we get stuck in habits.
I like it. Another thing you can do is, if you're right-handed, eat with your left.
Yeah.
It will make you think about every bite. It will make you think about it. And thinking differently is, can be in and of itself a good thing. You're getting closer to how the cosmos works, not the way you expect.
So the second thing would have to do with habit when it comes to doing some creative act. I would say that with creativity, we all try and reach for some end goal, and the camera's on, or there's someone watching, even if we're just watching ourselves, and taking the viewer out of the activity. A good example would be, you're being recorded right now, and the things that you're saying might not be the same things that you'd say to any one of us in a room by yourself. You're gonna vomit out the words, and it's gonna be what you hope to say, but it might be something completely different. Oh, I should have said this, or I shouldn't have said this in the way I did. And it's kind of an uneasiness that comes from being in the spotlight. And so a good example would be, okay, I'm playing a guitar and I'm singing and I have these ideas. If I do it on my own, then I'm going to come up with the greatest things. That's how it works. I work in the music industry. The second thing would be, if I'm doing it in front of you, it's probably going to be shitty because it's not random. And then the third thing would be, as far as mindlessness goes, the most habitual changing time in my life was when I was younger and working in professional recording studios, mindlessly doing a thing for the first time in my life after high school. And I...
Question, what's the question?
Well, I'm making 3 points.
We have a period. Okay, it's okay.
Finish that one.
And the last point would be, once you start intellectualizing on things, I think you get stuck in habits.
Okay.
So I was wondering what you'd have to say about those things.
All right. Real quick.
Yes. No, I think those are all very good.
Right. As a clarification for the rules here, we're going to have a rebuttal period. After the question and answer period, we get a chance to get up to the mic and say what you need to say as far as the thing. And it'll be you and the microphone and the everybody else after the question period. So please continue, and my apologies for interrupting.
Frank Aguilar.
With all this talk about analyzing your behavior and changing, how many of the people who engage into that type of whatever bullshit end up committing suicide? It seems like the United States have more suicides than people die more from suicide than automobile accidents. Are they all practicing all this bullshit?
That's actually a really good point. There are different suicide rates in different societies at different times, and I don't think it's random. One talk that I have percolating, as awful as it has been for you to survive this, I actually have other talks. One talk that I have percolating is theories of causation. Different societies have different explanations for why things happen. And societies can change those explanations over time. And some societies' explanations are very complete. They work very well in the world, which a lot of which means they deal with apparent random chance. And some are very strictured and very limited. And since the world keeps doing what it wants, no matter whether we happen to approve of what it does or not, a society whose explanation of why things happen, their theory of causation, is closer to the world, is going to be more harmonious. taking that, I would say, current American society's explanation of why things happen is pretty crappy compared to other societies. And so you do get a higher rate of suicide from that. I mean, there are many reasons people commit suicide, right? I'm talking about a subset of the entire thing. And, yeah, so someday that'll be a talk and we'll cover that,
yeah,
I think. Yeah, that's a good point.
Are you all familiar with the discussion of habits in Summa Theologica? Anything you say about it?
No. I do make a habit of not talking about what I don't know about.
Yeah, well,
I understand. This is a work I've wanted to tangle with, but I've not so far. So I don't have an intelligent opinion.
Tom Ford.
Question, any thoughts on the origin of where habit began way, way back? Have you done any research on that? Was it like to escape the animals, you hunkered down when it got dark, you know, that kind of based on a daily routine? Was there any thought on where we acquired that sense of repetition to be safe?
Well, it should be noted, I am completely unqualified to have, form, or express these views in any official sense. So I have done no research. I belong to the old school of philosophy, which means if I can sit down and figure it out until I learn something better, it's okay and I'm going to go with it. But I will tell you that if you are a creature that can react to the world, right, rocks don't do this, there's some plants that don't seem to do this. If you're a creature that can react to the world, habit is going to be part of the mix. And it's not until you get to volition, I'm deciding to do this, I've thought about it, decided to do it, that you can talk about habit in the way that we're talking about it now. And I think it's an outgrowth. I think the structure of habit, that is a mind that acts habitually, comes from when we were protozoa, and when you know when you get this stimulus, if you don't move, you're going to die, right? That comes, that idea. In other words, I don't think we've ever not had habit. I think there are some people who can live without habit. Those would be really interesting people. But I think a few of them do exist. But I think we've always had
it. All right, so. Federal employee. People come in.
You were
pay
a
their
federal employee.
Tax. Am I supposed to say, well, we got tired of the old habit of the way you're doing this. We're going to be creative today. You might end up paying a lot more than normal, but we don't want to be standardized. You know. Like,
yeah.
That's kind of like stifles creativity, you know. Right. Is this what you're recommending?
It would be more interesting.
Yeah, I just don't understand. If I cross the street at the corner, and you're telling me, well, do it in the middle of the block.
Do what?
Be more of a person or something?
No, I understand that it's...
It'll enrich my life?
I'm not suggesting we get rid of habit. I am not suggesting we get rid of habit. For one thing, it would be totally exhausting. I'm not trying to say how you should live. I'm trying to explain how we do live. I'm going to suggest, given the nature of the cosmos, that you're going to live better if you're able to understand there will be change. But that's not the same as saying you should give up all habits. Maybe you should break up a few habits to get used to the idea, but I'm not saying you should give up all habits. I mean, I'm talking to you, and I'm using English, and it's a lingua franca, to borrow the French. And so it's, you know what I mean? That's a really good habit. Otherwise, I'd be standing up here silently, and you'd be wondering what's wrong with me. You know, there's all sorts of habits that are very useful.
I mean, this might be difficult with a relationship.
Like Foley, then Victor, then Dan.
Mr. Foley.
This lecture was really a great lecture.
Thank you.
You spoke about human behavior, various forms of human behavior, isn't that? My question is sort of about what came before that, such as what motivates people, or what people seek or desire as they go through life. Before they even start doing it, what are people trying to get out of life, or what motivates people?
That's another talk.
It really is.
I have some thoughts on that. But I think we'd annoy everyone else with a question on this talk.
Okay.
All right. Very good.
It's still a great lecture.
Thank you.
Okay. Victor?
Yeah. I was just wondering, how does tradition fit into habits? Is it the enforcement of habits, or is it just a set of habits that is enforced?
When you say this tradition,
there are some societies that die for their traditions.
Yeah.
And that tradition may be just a set of habits that they rigidly have, hold on to.
I would argue defining a tradition in a society as just a set of habits is a perfectly fine tradition.
Called
customs. Well, some societies might not advance if they hold to the traditions.
I think that's absolutely correct. I agree with you.
So I was.
If I missed your question, I'm sorry. I agree with what you said.
Dan, if you're still ready with your question.
I have a question, yes. 80% of people have. What about creative people? Artists, writers, musicians, poets. Do they have habits too? Are they habitually creative, or is that impossible?
This is actually a very important point that I didn't bring out when I went through my notes. I can do a separate slide on that. When I say 80% of the people use one or two of these sentences to explain what they're doing, I'm not saying that 80% of the people use those explanations 100% of the time. I'm saying in any given person's life, 80% of the time, what they're doing can be explained by one or two of those sentences. So there are people who live very interesting creative lives where you say lots of stuff is not habitual. But they can't start the day without reading the New York Times every day. You know what I mean? So yeah. It's not like if you become creative, then you cannot have habits.
Right.
That's not how it works.
So everybody has habits.
Everybody has habits. Right. I need to take that back. I am given to understand, which is what I say when I don't really know this for sure. I am given to understand that there are some people who have achieved a level of mental inspiration that they do not do the habit thing at all. I don't think I've ever met one. I'd like to. I think it would be interesting. Probably annoying as all hell, but I think it would be interesting. But I won't say that you must have habits. Everybody I run into, including myself, is largely driven by habits. But that doesn't mean 80% of the people are only habitual 100% of the time. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
I also think you can, to go further with what you asked, I also think you can become habitually more creative. It's still structurally going to limit you because it is a habit, but you could also become habitually less creative. You know what I mean? Which would be a bad thing. But you could do that. I know what's right and I am going to ignore any other thing. Right? You can do that.
I just wanted to comment on the thing about habit. There was a question back there, where did it come from? You were saying, Bill, like from protozoas way back, you know, and it, your nervous system, okay? We're built for survival. Whatever we do, there's a reason for it, survival of the species. And the thing about the habit is your brain defaults to stuff that takes less energy. It takes less energy to do what you've done before because you know how to do it, and it supports. So it's, you know, whether you call it habit or get into the neuroscience of it, but there's evidence to show that it's harder to pull back and go, okay, I've done it that way. It's always like that, but you know what? I'm just going to shut that off and try something different, and then I'm going to evaluate it, and maybe I'll like it, and then you keep repeating.
And in several of the answers I've given up here, I've said, when people suggest living habitlessly, my first thought is that would be exhausting.
Exactly.
Exactly. Exactly. Oh.
When I was a little boy and I would put on a coat, I would always go to like this to try to put my hand into the sleeve.
Right.
And my parents showed me, don't do that. They said, do it this way. Put your hand down into the sleeve. It's so much easier and it works. And it was
it's safer too than whapping someone.
But I still put my hand in the sleeve in the top, instinctually. And so the thing is that I think it's the human challenge to try to break away from the habits that are either inefficient, unpractical, or more destructive to us, and to try to reinforce habits that are good for us. I was never a great writer, although I was glad when I got into the third grade and began to learn cursive writing, but I was never a real good writer of it. And since that time, my handwriting has only degenerated even worse. But I think that good handwriting is something that would be a habit that we should try to reinforce. So we should try to work on making the habits that are good more reinforced. We should work on keeping those habits and having them even more. And the habits that are bad, we should work on getting rid of. And I think that's part of individual self-perfection.
Okay.
I'm going to say something that should impress you. I agree with half of what you said. Most people were impressed. That's a very high percentage.
You know, I am trying to learn how to peel a banana, and I always do it the wrong way,
yes.
But that's my...
We need to come back to that, because there's an important point.
Everybody peels a banana different. I do it the wrong way.
Yeah, but you ought to be creative, Frank. You know what I mean? Okay. Smash it. Smash it, Nita. Because we don't want to be stifled.
Quiet.
Full out of time.
We've got to be creative.
Yeah, right.
You didn't answer your question. I believe Thelonious Monk was known for never playing a solo the same way. Okay.
Louder, please.
I believe Thelonious Monk was known for not playing a solo the same way as far as habit is concerned. The other thing is, I read recently that the hippocampus takes the short-term and the long-term memory and gives it to the frontal lobe. And if it doesn't, well, maybe I shouldn't go any further if you're not familiar with it. My question was, this could have some impact on behavior. And I'm wondering if you got into this at all.
I don't know anything about how the famous they yeah. think the brain does that.
Okay.
Don't. I do have something to say about solos. How many of you know the Handel organ concertos? Which one? How many of you know any of them at all? Okay. Do you know the musical scholarship problem with the Handel organ concertos? I mean, when the great masters write stuff, usually it's like, is this really his? Or is this some student who wrote it down, maybe a little different, or some imitator, right? It's a big problem. Handel wrote the Messiah in 3 weeks. You know how many notes there are on the Messiah? Right? It's a huge piece of work. So he was a very fast copyist. He just heard it and wrote it. So he has these 16 organ concertos. And people would come to him and say, you know, that one you did last night was great. I'll give you £5 if you give me a copy. I want to learn it and play it for my friends. Cool. So Handel was a pigsty. He was a mess as a record keeper. And he would look around his mess and say, well, and he would sit down and write them another one. So the opposite problem in most cases for musical scholarship, you don't have the Handel organ concerto in the master's hand. You have like 8 or 10 or 12 of them. And they're all slightly different. Yeah. Right? Because he would do what the hell sounded good to him. He got the melody in, it was fine. There's a little variation that's a 4-5 harmony structure instead of the 3, but it's fine, you got, right? Real masters don't care about that crap. We who are limited in what we can handle, okay, there's notes coming up, I know that I have a lot of trouble with this passage, I gotta get it, right? We who have trouble with this, we worry about that kind of crap. Real masters, it just goes, whatever, it's fine, it's there. And I don't know whether that comes from the hippocampus or the thing, I don't know. But I'll tell you that's true.
How about the ego?
Okay, Raj Patel.
People who do not have a range of experiences, okay, they have strong habits. And people have lots of range of experiences, they do not have a strong habit. What is your take on that?
I disagree. Okay. Whether you form habits to control what you do or don't do, or whether you're more free-flowing, however you want it, less habitual, I don't think it has anything to do. I think it has very little to do with what kind of experiences you have. There are people who live what we would think of as a cloistered life, alone in the village, they know 20 other people, they read 3 books in their lives, who have achieved a level of non-habitualness that would be impressive. There are people who have flown around the world with jobs every week, who know 12 languages, who, et cetera, achieve several postdoctorate things, who are rigidly controlled. I don't think that, I understand the point, and I think it has some correlation. You'd think more experience would allow you to be less habitual. But there are people who are crazy, who have plenty of experiences are totally bound. And there are people who live very simple lives, very regularized lives, who are emotionally and habitually speaking, freer. It has to do with what you make of yourself. And the circumstances you live might help some, might not. I don't think there's a strong correlation between those two.
Don, were you stretching before, or did you want to ask a question?
Okay.
All right, Charlie.
Last question. Let's get the rebuttals.
All right, Bill, from what I've heard thus far, parents should not instruct, punish or reward their children because this would inculcate habits and stifle their creativity. So I guess you should just let them run wild?
What a lovely question. You'll be disappointed to know that I think I have a very good answer. It is an obligation of parents to do something that unfortunately is completely contradictory. Past basic safety and, food and shelter and stuff like that. One obligation of parents is to provide as rich an experience of life as you can. Less habitual, in short words. However, another obligation of parents is to provide your children with the ability to live well in the world. If we lived in a world where habituality, I made up that word there, if habituality were rare, then it would be a good thing to encourage creativity. But we don't live in a world like that. Creative thinking is a problem in our world. It's bad for you to think creatively. It's unusual and frowned upon in most all circumstances. In certain societies, it's really a bad idea. It will make you dead. So the answer is yes and no. Parents should raise their children to be creative unless habitually bound, but they also need to live in a world where habit is common. This is only one of the great paradoxes from which you really understand why life is so very interesting.
So if my kid's a young Republican, I can't say anything?
I would discourage that. And I'll leave you to figure out which part of your sentence I would discourage.
All right. Ram, let's get in, start getting into rebuttals.
Yeah,
now.
Let's get to rebuttal. Now. Let's get this guy.
Let's hear it again for the speaker.
This has been a great deal of fun. I'd love to do this more.
Even playing musical chairs, but I don't think the chairs are arranged properly for that. But how many people here have something to tell the rest of us? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Well, I would say maybe 5 minutes apiece.
You got it, Brom.
All right. You exceed or get close to your 5 minute limit. Tim will make a T sign.
Or I'll get timeout.
Right.
And then I'll also give you a warning at about a minute beforehand.
Okay. All right. Beginning with
me.
Whoever, Joe Mayer is closest, and Bill Wendt was moving up. Okay, and the call is clear. Okay, you guys, starting with Joe Mayer, proceeding with Bill Wendt, and said, okay.
All right.
And I'll go see the
up until about 1847, the science of physics, or the physical sciences as they were called, were pretty much established. There was nothing really important to discover. By 1893, even though there had been the Lorentz contraction equations, it was considered in most universities to downplay the teaching of the physical sciences because there was nothing new to discover. And so it became a habit that you went to college, if you were lucky, and you learned the same Newtonian equations, Maxwell's electromagnetic equations, and that was it. You know, there was nothing else to do. And then there was a few idiots who thought outside the box. I don't know how they thought, but they were pretty good. And they came up, Einstein, of course, with his special relativity, then 13 years later with his general theory of relativity, and then some really out-of-the-way people, they were called the Copenhagen group. They started this concept of quantum mechanics, that there was no certainty in the quantum world, in the microscopic world. And the rest of the physics community did everything they could to disprove that, but it persisted because it answered certain questions. So that habit began to change in the physics community, in the scientific community. Even though Mendeleev had developed the concept of the periodic table of elements some years before, that was just a modification of what was already known. But by 1930, quantum mechanics was perfectly well established, and it became decreed. You studied quantum mechanics and so in college, your PhD or your postdoc work was in the field of quantum mechanics. And no one yet has been able to disprove that, although there are certain efforts that are ongoing at the present time. So our speaker's concept of the habitual nature of 80% of the people doing 80% of their thinking in the habitual manner is by and large effective, except for that small group of people who keep screwing up our lives.
Next.
Where's Charlie? Oh, wait,
well, anyway, I saw the building for this talk, and I thought it would be a perfect springboard for the kind of economics I've been studying for about the past 40 years. That everyone is trying to substitute a more preferable situation for a less preferable situation. And you can build a whole system of economics around that. It runs into a lot of conflict with habits. I think some people understand denial over it. And that's even if their present habits, they don't seem to be concerned about some kind of economic meltdown if they don't change. But I'm collecting emails to send out and at least introduce people to some of the basics of this concept. It's my own version of it, but plenty of stuff that's...
What about the batteries?
It's a little horse's mouth, so to speak.
What?
But,
oh, for me?
I've got a little too much to say for this rebuttal. And I'm going to have to forget something or another. But, habit is a very important concept. We've heard some of that tonight. And, look up some of Theologica if you get a chance. I guess that's about it. I can follow up on a lot of this.
I thought the main topic would be human nature, and I want to say a few words about that. There is such a thing as human nature, and that is that human beings are gregarious by nature. That's why we're able to communicate with one another. Why we communicate? In order to exist. Our early ancestors, they were hunters and gatherers for the most part. And if they didn't cooperate, they would die off, because this was the type of environment that was extremely precarious. So they had to communicate in order to survive. So I would say that is human nature. That we're gregarious by nature, and that is an extreme necessity. Now let's take chaos and order. Most people would think chaos and order are two polar opposites and have nothing to do with one another. But we need chaos in order to gain order. For instance, if somebody has a toothache, which is chaos, that more or less says to himself, I have to do something about it. And that means he has to go to the dentist and take care of it. When he takes care of it, that's order. Now, let's say you have an earthquake, like in Japan or other countries. That's chaos. But in order to solve that problem, they need science. They need to know about the construction of buildings and so forth, the topography of the land. And for this, since they had the earthquake, they have to do something to make the building safe. So that pushes them in the direction of trying to solve that problem. And when they solve that problem, not only do they get order, but they get an order on a higher level than before. So order is what we're looking for. And for instance, Vicky was saying that that she couldn't get one place because the road was bad in one place because that's the habit she went through. Let's say if they didn't fix that road, she would have more chaos. It only would only not be just for that particular time, but for other times, and a lot of people would have chaos, and the thing would be a mess. So we have to look at the science of whoever we're looking into to solve the problem of order and how to get on a higher level. The universe itself is order, but there's chaos in it. And there's no doubt about that. And one time, about quantum physics, they were talking about these photons. And they said they're separate and distinct, and they can't understand it. And that's part of quantum physics. But then when they examined it, they seen one part of the quantum was signaling the other part of the quantum. And that showed that it was a process, and there was an order in it. So it's not just chaos. Chaos just leads you to look for solutions so you can get order on a higher level. As far as habits are concerned, we need habits, otherwise we would die. Let's say somebody had to learn to walk every single day. You wouldn't be able to exist. Or if you learned how to drive a car, next time you came into a car, there was no order. So you need order, and you need habit. But sometimes the habit and the order goes wrong. That's when you look for new solutions, and that's where science and order come in.
That makes sense. All right.
Pretty good.
On a human nature, over last decade, I spent lots of time about America. Closest thing to paradise we can think of, we have. Okay, we are less hungry, we have less worries, unless we create them. In such a great country, and we started wrong when our forefathers said that all men equal. They did not mean it. It was false to start with, because not everybody can vote in a democracy at that time. When Abraham Lincoln liberated blacks, it wasn't liberation, it was emancipation. So blacks are no longer animals, but they were not equal to white men. And probably they are still not. But what bothers me is that we have a great opportunity to create a peace in the world. And over the last few years, we have destroyed Libya, Egypt, Iran, Syria, Iraq, And why are we doing that? What kind of human nature we have that we cannot make a peace? We do not make a... If there is nobody can defeat us. We got more weapons than we kill everybody 100 times probably. So what is that? What do we fear? And it bothers me night after night after night. Sometimes I get up, I cannot sleep. What is that? That we fear. What is in our nature? That we fear so much. We fear the guy who is 7,000 miles away and who doesn't have no capacity to come to us except unless we screw up. Okay? And what is that? We could be the force. We say, okay, no more war, we are going to make a peace. We are going to be for a good guy. Israel and Gaza. Why would we allow? We can understand their problem. We can understand they disagree. We understand they dislike. But to keep them like a cage animals in a garden, and we do not say anything? Okay, I respect Jews, and I have a great deal of respect for them, for their intelligence, their art, their creativity, their ability to make great Israeli state. But we are Americans. We believe in equal rights. Why did we allow that? Why did we allow so long? No, our newspaper did not publish it. Our TV did not create a program. The condition of that, they have to get an aspirin, they cannot get it. That is stupidity. And it bothers me that what is that in our nature that we do that? I think it is about time we have a national dialogue that, hey, we are not going to fight with weapons. We are going to fight with our wisdom, our capacity in a technology, our capacity in a management, our capacity in organizing, you know, and that will be great. Thank you.
There were two guys we read about in Scripture, that is, the New Testament. They were both inhabitants of Jericho. One was a beggar named Bartimaeus, and the other was Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was very rich because he was the chief tax collector. He's a tax farmer. And he collected the taxes. And he was, you know, in the pocket of the Romans, and the Romans were in his pocket, and he was an enemy alien as far as his comrades, his countrymen were concerned. And Bartimaeus was blind. He was a beggar. Now they're both in this town, and Jesus comes to town. He's on his way to Jerusalem. It's the feast of the Passover. It was. And so there are a lot of people going up to Jerusalem.
Okay.
But there's a big crowd of Jesus with his followers, his friends, who are going to Jerusalem to the temple for the big feast. And for the celebration of the liberation from slavery in Egypt. All right. So, Bartimaeus sees him coming and he says, Oh, Jesus, Son of David, have mercy on me. And they tell him, shut up, be quiet. And they sort of push him back. But he says all the louder, have mercy on me. Jesus, please. He's heard that Jesus does cures. He helps people who are blind. And who are beggars. And Jesus stops and says, send him over here. And guy comes up and says, he asks, well, what do you want from me? He says, if it's possible, give me my sight. And Jesus does what he can, and the guy can see better, a whole lot better. And he's no longer in a position to be the beggar that he was. It's a change of life, a change of habit. Then he goes further into town, and Zacchaeus is a short guy. And he climbs up a tree because he's not too popular. Tax collectors were never popular when they're tax collectors for a foreign army, as tax collectors in Jericho today are tax collectors for a foreign occupier. They might not be too popular. So anyhow, he climbs up a tree just to see Jesus. Why? Because he's heard that Jesus teaches, talks with, eats with, and even has followers who have been tax collectors.
Oh.
For Herod or for Rome. Well, not too kosher. Anyhow, he sees Jesus. Jesus sees him up in the tree. And he says, hey, Zacchaeus. Even Jesus knows who Zacchaeus is. Come on down. And he rushes down. He's recognized by this Messiah candidate, anyway. Okay. Zacchaeus, Jesus says, here, I want to stay with you tonight. Oh, boy, this is recognition and mercy, forgiveness, and he says, look, I'll do anything. I'm going to give half of all I've got to the poor. And I'm going to pay back anybody who has been cheated by my guys back four times over. Okay? And Jesus said, sure, yeah, good. Reform has come to this guy. Repentance. You know, this guy is also a son of Abraham. So, maybe we can reform too.
Yeah.
Oh, we need a reform.
Okay. Those who don't know me, I'm Doug.
Yes. What did Jesus
the Christian.
What did Jesus say?
But what I have to say, though, is it has anything to do with Christianity or religion. I just want to say that, you know, when Bill was giving his opening remarks, he brought back to mind something about in regards to habit that we've always done it that way, and it brought immediately to mind something we when I was in business, I'm an accountant by trade. That's what I did for my entire working life for 30 years. We used to talk about the seven steps of stagnation in a business enterprise, and one of them was that the comment that he made, we've always done it that way. Then there were six others, but I only remember offhand two others that we from the seven. We changed, but it didn't work. And another one is we've never done it that way. And there were some more, but that sort of adds to the substance of what Bill was talking about earlier. The other thing, being an accountant, you know, we were talking about habit, and, you know, there are certain principles of accounting. One is, you know, that you consistently report the numbers, you know, what's revenue, what's expense, that the figures that you report are comparable from period to period, so that, you know, I imagine some of you are investors and you watch the financials, and, you know, when you see a trend line for a series of numbers, you want to see that, you know, there's consistent growth or decline or whatever, that the numbers are comparable. And that's one of, like, they call it axioms of accounting. And if you manipulate the numbers, or the numbers aren't properly stated the way they should be, you know, you get bad results, or, you know, there's a lot of changes in accounting, believe it or not, that forces organizations to sometimes restate their numbers. The other thing is, I remember when I was in accounting, and most of you know the accounting, the equation as, you know, for a balance sheet, and a balance sheet is something where the total number of assets equals to the liabilities plus the equity. And our prof in my advanced accounting course asked us this question, trying to have us have an open mind. He said, if someone handed you a document where the assets were listed and the liabilities were subtracted to get equity, would you call that a balance sheet? And the obvious answer is yes, because it has all the elements of a balance sheet. It's just that the assets don't equal the liabilities plus the equity. Of course, equity is a shakeout of the net of netting of assets and liabilities. So that was an instance where, you know, he was teaching us to have an open mind, you know, as we got into the workforce, and, you know, not to be totally derailed when we saw a new type of reporting. The other thing is, another thing he mentioned in his talk was about how our habits are dictated by the cosmos. And one thing that came to mind is, you know, our cycle of in the Northern Hemisphere of reaping our crops. We plant in the spring, the crops grow in the summer, and then we harvest in the fall. And we also kind of watch nature too, because, you know, in nature we see the trees in the fall lose their leaves, so we know that winter is coming and we should prepare. We also notice that the animals, especially squirrels, and other type ground animals will start harvesting food that you want to store up for the winter months. Bears will hibernate, and so we kind of follow suit. We, you know, follow nature in that sense. And it's interesting that, you know, in our Earth orbit around the sun, is that, you know, the planet Earth at various positions, you know, in the spring and the fall, are a perfect relation to the sun that enables us to, you know, to have our crop growing in the summer, and then, like I said, planting, and the sunlight is you get the right amount of sunlight at those times of year, you know, the spring and the fall for.
And Doug, you're out of time.
Growing already.
What does the vernal equinox have to do with habits?
That's the punchline.
Because it's the time of the season to do something.
It's a repetition.
To do its planting. Get ready for the growing season.
It's habits.
It's a habit?
Thank you.
That's a plant in the middle of the room.
I'm Michael Foley.
It's been an habit.
Actually, Charlie, the vernal equinox is a habit. It comes at the same time every year. I just want to thank the speaker. Who's playing with the telephones?
Me, sorry.
I just wondered, that's all. Go ahead, Lana.
It's okay.
Anyway, I want to thank the speaker for being here. I'm one of those people that believe that the vast majority of human behavior has very simple explanations.
sometimes you observe something and you look at it and you think, man, this don't make no sense. Well, that's when the phrase, there's more to this than meets the eye, come in. A lot of times when you look at something that don't make any sense, after you find out the whole story, you think, yeah, that does make a lot of sense. It's very understandable. That's about all I got to say.
Okay.
My name is Dan Weinberg. I want to thank the speaker for. He should be a comedian. All right, so.
Trouble was he's sitting.
Well, he stands up. It's funny. Habits. This talk, what I have to say might go against some of your habits. So Zionism in 1948 did not see the Arabs living there in Palestine. My cousin was born in the King David Hospital in Jerusalem in about 1945, and he was designated a Palestinian. And the expulsions of Arabs from Israel happened by the Jewish Israelis. And this caused the refugee camps. So Zionism is racism and apartheid. As are most of today's 196 or so independent countries. And what is a country? Is it like the Donetsk People's Republic? Which is the declared country by a bunch of people proudly supported by Russia. The Donetsk People's Republic is or was part of the Ukraine. So is it legitimate as Israel? Israel is certainly built up more than the Donetsk People's Republic. How does that make Israel legitimate? So what is the solution to the Israel problem? How about a confederation between Jordan, since it is more than 50% Palestinian, Israel, the West Bank, and Gaza? The total population of Palestinians is estimated to be 1.7 million in Gaza, 2.7 million on the West Bank, 3 million in Jordan, and 1.6 inside Israel. So altogether, there are approximately 9 million Arabs plus 6.1 million Jews in Israel for a total of approximately 15.1 million people in the new country. Would the Confederation solve the Israel-Palestinian problems? I am not sure. There would still be problems, but the main problem would be solved. So if you have a habit of thinking one way, you can change your habits and think another way. And that's my opinion, and I'm going to stick by it.
All right, let's thank our speaker again. Very well prepared lecture here. He's got a variety of topics he covered. I'll be eclectic as usual here. Human nature is essentially a concept that's is a Christian concept. They define man in a certain fashion, and therefore they define the entire world. It's a package belief system. But they say man is of such a nature, he's sinful, he requires redemption, and redemption is achievable through us. That's the basic Sales position. Human nature, if anything, I'll go so far as to say that we are a sum total of our relationships. There's no essential or definable person or human being that we can ascertain. people do in fact have personalities, and this is brought about through growing up, rearing, education. So you do develop a core personality, and that's achieved through positive and negative reinforcement and instruction. Like you, Dave was saying, he received instructions on the appropriate utilitarian way to do certain things. The one thing about personality is that they're consistent. As a matter of fact, you're saying break habits. I don't know if you necessarily want to break all habits. Now, what I mean by your personalities are consistent. Once they're developed, you do not radically change as a person. And the classic example of that is whether or not a person is charitable or not. They used to collect for charities. And some people would say, well, I gave to the church or I gave here already, but I won't be giving. No, I'm already given enough. No, a charitable person is charitable. And they remain consistent. Regardless of whatever their financial situation is, they are going to make a contribution. That's why it does absolutely no good to try to apply any pressure on someone who's acting against their nature or their personality that they develop. So yes, there is consistency over time. Okay, I'm gonna jump around another one. You mentioned there Roosevelt and the New Deal. I've got a whole explanation how the New Deal worked. I'll send it to you and anybody else that wants one. I've had it for a number of years. Yes, the New Deal in fact works. Small, another little issue is I'm not an armaments person. They did have repeating rifles in the Civil War. You are correct, the military was slow to adapt it. But I believe the Confederate soldiers were complaining that the Yankees could load on Sunday and fight all week. So they did have automatic rifles. Democracy, I've heard another thing here. They believe that, and it lasted up until, of course, this century, that only certain individuals, you can look at it two ways. Who is denied the ability to vote, or who do you have voting? And quite honestly, we have more democracy than they have in Greece. We have pluralistic voting. They had no such thing in Greece or any other republic or democracy. Pluralistic, everyone can vote. And actually, it makes a great deal of sense the way they did in the United States here. You want responsible people. When you guys get done, let me know.
Okay.
All right, you want responsible people voting. And I often do this when I vote. I had a woman that worked for me. She was a total nincompoop. She voted too, but she didn't know what she was voting. She had no concept. She had, honestly, she had no idea whatsoever. So that's the kind of government you're going to get if you allow everybody. I think the more qualifications you have in voting, the better. Pendulums, I've actually investigated those and tried them out at work. You mentioned instincts. An instinct is a response that is automatic. If somebody mentioned autonomic nervous systems, it's like you're pre-wired. And if a stimulus is given, the response is already in the individual. I'm almost done. So an instinct, we see them in animals. He mentioned them, some of these things, the behaviors that they have. It comes out of comparative psychology. Instincts are something, some of we have them like blinking the eye and things like that. Instincts are not learned behavior. They're, by virtue of being the creature, they're already incorporated. You mentioned, you hit on a good one there, society. Now, your conflict there, you got habits, you say, oh no, it's habits and habits, oh my God, you stifle my creativity. Societies have mores and norms of behavior, and let me tell you, you better not stray too far from those. There's customs, and you can come up with some change, but that's only going to be on the bell-shaped curve on the end. You try too much of this, it's going to be problematic. But no, you have to adapt the culture and the society that you're in, and you have to learn that. That's acculturation that comes in. You hit on that right there. Those traditions, even the beliefs of the society you're in, you did hit on those. Every society has explanations, worldview that they use. Yeah, some of them are strange and bizarre, and some are better than others in many respects. But yeah, it's kind of hard to stray from it, though. You're gonna get ostracized if you try to be too much the iconoclast individual. All right, thank you.
All right.
Yeah.
You're not for pluralistic voting now, are you?
Well, I don't know what pluralistic voting means.
Any jalump that shows up gets a ballot.
Well, that's... Okay. All right, well, I'm glad you made that point, Charlie, because the truth of the matter...
Dumb Bill.
Okay, I can see why Ron...
That's going to get fixed.
Yeah.
All right.
He wants to change.
One fool at a time, Charlie.
You got to change it.
One fool... Hey, Charlie, your rebuttal is over, okay? Now, I thought this was a real interesting lecture, and actually, I would like to say that this turned out to be a much more interesting lecture tonight than I expected it to be. So, one of our things our speaker tonight said is that, he says he believes more in the, if I remember correctly, the old school philosophy, figuring it out on your own, rather than doing research. I'm more of a believer in doing research and getting your facts right. Now, a lot of the points I was going to make were actually already made for me by Charlie. And the most amazing thing, like some kind of synchronicity, is that Charlie made them in the same order, having to do with FDR and the New Deal, the Civil War, and the nature of democracy. I would just want to say, first of all, I should apologize to our speaker and to everybody in the college for interrupting him during his lecture. That was wrong of me. And when I've been moderator in the past, I kept saying to people one fool at a time, and I broke my own rule, a rule that I believe in. I was wrong to do that, and I apologize. It doesn't matter if you're right or not. If you do something wrong, okay. Well, thank you, Elon. Now. That being said, I just want to say again that what he said about FDR and the New Deal was total bullshit. Okay?
Yeah.
Now, during the first year, first of all, he said that, you know, we practice Keynesian economics because we've always done it that way. Well, not in 1933 we hadn't. That's why they call it the New Deal. Okay? It was a new way of doing things, thinking outside the box. Second, in the first year after FDR took office, the gross domestic product increased by 10%, actually more, it was like 11%, and it did the same thing, more than 10% the following year and the following year, okay? And that's better growth than we had during the boom years, the Clinton years in the 90s. Now, Charlie was absolutely right about the Civil War, repeating rifles, and by the way, the mass production of firearms with interchangeable parts as it was invented by Eli Whitney, the same guy who was also known for having invented the cotton gin. That was at the beginning of the 19th century when Thomas Jefferson was president. Now, the question of whether the U.S. is a democracy really depends on your definition of democracy, but I would say that, you know, yeah, an Athenian might disagree because it doesn't fit, it's not the same as the government in Athens, but the way people use the word, you know, I tend to believe more in that words, in a descriptive view of what words mean rather than prescriptive, and saying that if people aren't using the word the way it was originally used, then they're wrong. The way people use the word now, you know, to mean a government elected or in some way determined by the people, that the United States is a democracy. If you don't like the people that are running the government, you know, get rid of them. I mean, I got on my t-shirt two former governors of Illinois who are now in prison. That's where I think a lot of our politicians belong, but that's just my opinion.
George is out.
Who? Oh, he's out? Oh, okay. Well, good on him. All right. Now, finally, I wanted to say that Brahm referred to referred to Jericho as, in the present day, now, paying taxes to a foreign occupier. I'm not, now, Jericho is under the jurisdiction of the Palestinian Authority now, not the State of Israel, and so they pay taxes to the Palestinian Authority. Now, I, since the Palestinian Authority is Palestinians, I wouldn't exactly call it a foreign occupier, even if you say that the Jewish state is foreign. And you were just finished. Let me finish, Brown. You just finished talking about Jesus and Zacchaeus and all these guys. What were they? They were Jews. They were living there 2,000 years ago, long before the modern state of Israel came into existence. Okay, so there have been Jews in Israel for a hell of a long time. I wouldn't exactly call them foreign. Now I largely agree with Charlie, and as I pointed out, he made the same points I did. But one area where I would disagree is this about the perils of thinking of the perils of deviating from society's mores. You know, society is not perfect. There are a lot of problems. Real change for the better, is not made by people who keep their nose to the grindstone and follow the rules and do everything the way they're supposed to. Real positive change in society is made, I'm almost finished, Tim, real positive change is made by people who are creative, who think outside the box.
You just apologize for not following the rules.
Who break the, right, who, and who do things different. And that's all I got to say on the subject.
Yeah. And then he says he's sorry for breaking rules, and then he tells us to break rules.
Do I contradict myself? Very well, then. I contradict myself.
I'm large. I would like to thank tonight's speaker for an excellent and a stimulating presentation.
Yes. Here.
Charlie, unlike you, I believe in what you call pluralistic voting. It's the hallmark of democracy that every citizen,
yeah, the name comes
from. Every citizen, no matter how well or ill informed, gets their say at the polling place. And yes. And as an old-time Chicago and Cook County Democrat, my attitude can be summed up as vote early and often. And then I'm all in favor of the things that we've done here in the past, including seeing to it that on Election Day, every last wino on West Madison is registered to vote, is thanked once they do so with a bottle of either cheap whiskey or Muscatel and a few bucks in the pocket. And I'm all in favor of similar tactics elsewhere. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, hang on, Rob.
By the way, the people who collect border trade dues for the tariffs are still the Jewish authorities. They have to guard the borders and they collect the taxes.
Customs.
You know, it's kind of funny how habits are formed. I can still remember to the day that I formed one of my best habits that I ever described. I can remember to this day driving down Algonquin Road at about 8:08 in the morning, flipping my radio dial to station after station. I was about 28 years old and out of the service, and I used to like, you know, all these rock and roll stations in the morning. There was a particular program called Howard Stern that I wasn't exactly a fan of, but there's only so much that a 28-year-old guy can take with hearing about women's body parts in the morning. So as I'm flipping through the dial, I decided to start way at the end of the FM dial. And all of a sudden, I come upon this little known radio station in 1988 called 91.5 FM. It's called WBEZ. And from that day forward, I discovered the joys of public radio. It not only was an infinite joy, but soon became a habit. Something that I enjoy to this day that has been probably one of the most life-changing habits I've ever desired. The other question I have for you guys is, what caused it for me to become a habit to come here and tape you guys every week? Is it constructive?
No.
You betcha. Is it an intellectually stimulating thing? No. Is it fun? You betcha. Let's thank our speaker again tonight for a good presentation and a good set of rebuttals.
That's it.
We
will hear from our speaker, Bill Geraci.
All right.
How long
do I get?
Till 9 o'clock.
Yeah.
Got at least another 10.
Maybe
at least 15 minutes, Bill. At least 15 minutes.
The Bible, you know, the other one was so good, you know.
Okay, everybody. You guys are good. Notice I don't necessarily mean every bloody one of you. But you guys are good. I have some comments in, to make. It is my habit to rebut the rebuttals. I don't get to give my own rebuttal, like, independent from what you guys said, because I had the speaker was the block of time.
No, we understand that.
Okay. Well, I just thought I'd make that clear. Here we are. Our third rebuttalist talked about human nature being gregarious. It should be noted that my talk was not an exhaustive examination of all the aspects of human nature. I'd like to do that sometime. That would be fun. With regard to gregariousness particularly, Aristotle said a lot of things. One of the things he said was there are two kinds of creatures who can live without, two kinds of creatures that are human-like, who can live without society. Anybody recall his definition? Does that ring a bell? One kind of creature that's a human-like that can live without society is the madman. And the other kind of creature that's human-like that can live without society are the gods. I thought that was so insightful. We really do need each other. Not necessarily every one of us, but in general, we need each other. Chaos out of order. I have a lot to say about this. So, there's chaos from the rebuttal, there's chaos, and then you can use science, there are other techniques you can use, but you can use science to bring order out of chaos. I like that, that's good. But it's not complete. And it's conceptually flawed. The better explanation for how this works is the three major Hindu gods. And how they interact. And as I'm sure you all know, and I'll tell you anyway, there are three major Hindu gods. There's Brahma, Vishnu, and not Krishna, he was a Shiva. Okay? Why do they have three? Well, you could actually argue Christianity has three, but that's okay. Why do the Hindus have three?
Well, Chinese have three.
Do the Chinese? I don't know Chinese question. So the Hindu religion has three major gods, and they represent creation, and they represent sustaining, that is, things going on as they are, and they represent destruction. And in the Hindu religion, you never, ever have creation without knowing you need destruction. And of course, sustaining is continuing as things are. It's elegant, all right? It's actually elegant. One of the flaws of Christianity is that you have a beginning point, and you have things that happen, and you have an end point. And that, friends and neighbors, is not how the cosmos actually works.
It's not teleological.
Anything that starts does not start from nothing. And anything that ends is not a final place. It's always a beginning of something else. And this is inherent structurally in the idea of the Hindu religion. And its lack is inherent in the Christian religion. And this is a problem in my opinion. And I really loved it. How many of you know TQM, Total Quality Management? You ever heard of that?
Yeah.
right? This is the idea that you have a business process going on, and you assess the business process, and then you analyze what you should do, and you make changes, and then you look at how the business process is working, and then you make changes, and then you look how it's going, and you make changes, and they had a circle up there on the board at the class I attended. And I waited till everybody else had left out of the room. And I went up to the professor at the end of this session, training session for staff, right? Real people who actually do stuff, not just this theoretical crap. And I said, you do realize that this is an infiltration, a philosophical infiltration into the Christian West of these circular ideas of Hinduism, of the East, where there is no end without being some other beginning, where there is no beginning without depending on some other end. I'm not sure he knew what I was talking about.
Yeah, we don't either.
Well, you certainly should. I thought I laid it out very nicely.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay? So, you know, having a chaos and then using science to gain order, that's like a quarter of what's going on. It's this continual rolling, circular idea that actually is much more fruitful. Because if you think you can start somewhere and do something and then end and then go home, you're going to get a hit upside the head, because that's not how the cosmos operates. It's a constant process. There is nothing except the constant process.
Life is circular? What am I coming from?
My arguments are not, but yes, lots of life. See, aren't you guys annoyed you let me come up and rebut? I have all this interesting stuff. There's 8,000 pages of notes here.
What cycle am I in right now?
You want me to explain it to you? 21 years ago, you were David Koresh. And when his life ended, you became Charlie Paydock. You were Charlie Paydock for 21 years.
I flew back from Wakefield here for Saturday night for this.
I know that, Charlie. When David Koresh's existence ended, yours started.
I was at the college.
It's an infinite process. You asked the question, Charlie, I answered it for you.
So as I was saying, our fourth rebuttalist made some very interesting points, very heartfelt points, appealing points, about why we fear someone 7,000 miles away. And I have something to say on that. There are two reasons we fear that person 7,000 miles away, who may never do anything to us. The first way to solve, the first way to begin to, since it's a process, the first way to begin to solve that problem is to eliminate the idea of the zero-sum game. Eliminate the mental habit of the zero-sum game. That is, if I make $10,000 more per year, you have to make $10,000 less. Right? As long as the idea that someone else's benefit is going to be my loss is the idea that rules, we are in big trouble as individuals and as a human species and as societies and as countries and as everything else. Because there are things where that's true. I mean, if I have two cups of water and I pour water into one, that gets there are things where that's correct. But in the world of the human endeavor, where people make up shit, the zero-sum game does not apply. I can invent a technology that will make everyone, including myself, better, richer, faster, smarter, handsomer, whatever. But the idea of a zero-sum game means I have to keep him down in order to keep me elevated. And that's part of the world psychology, and that's a problem. The second thing you have to understand, to understand why people fear people 7,000 miles away who they've never heard of, is that somebody in the current system profits from that fear. There are people who make money, who have livelihoods, who put kids through college based on that fear. And so there are people who are interested. It is in their interest to maintain that fear. You have to find a way to solve it for that. If you can get people to understand that you may be making money on this, but you can make money in a more constructive way, it will aid in getting rid of these unreasonable fears. Not irrational fears, but unreasonable fears. That's where I would start. That's what occurred to me as he was saying that. Yeah, okay, I have some other stuff here, but I can't remember enough of the context. I was too excited about what I just said. All right, I have some other talks coming up, I hope, and I have some additional talks, and I have more talks. And, by the way, you may recall at the very beginning, I encourage you to find other places or help me find other places to give talks like this. I have some things to say that may be of use to people. I hope you agree, and I thank you for your kind attention.
All right. I like the Bible story.